The Hillside Stranglers. Several years ago, I was working in the north room of the old British Library in the British Museum, where they used to send you if your books seemed at risk of damage or so naughty that you might mutilate them. And I noticed that the young woman at the desk next to me was working from The Mind of Billy Milligan. That meant we had interests in common. Billy Milligan was a rather nasty rapist, but his defence of insanity exposed the most dramatic and fascinating case of multiple personality since The Three Faces of Eve first drew attention to this possibility of, well, fairly genuine Jekyll and Hyde, or Jekyll and Hide-and-Seek, by which the minds of frightened children can use voices in the head to try and escape from their fears and self-doubts. Of course, the fact that only two of Billy Milligan's eight or more imaginary personalities participated in crimes doesn't change the fact that Billy Milligan and no one else was experienced by a number of college women as an extremely nasty rapist. Even those psychiatrists who think he's the best discovery since Oedipus and Jocasta don't think he should have been set at large with a free pardon and wired for sound so that researchers could find out how a multiple personality behaves. Ah, but Billy Milligan did seem to have indicated a way by which a rapist who went further and killed his victims might escape the death penalty. So at least thought Kenneth Bianchi. The Hillside Stranglings began in October 1977, when the naked body of a 19-year-old black girl was found dumped in a ravine in Hollywood near Universal City. She was a part-time waitress with a 2-year-old daughter to feed, so she also put out for extra money. That meant she could be described as a prostitute and everyone felt better. There really is something very nasty about the way we all tend to stop thinking of women as fellow human beings and creatures of value to God the moment they decide to earn part of their income by selling sexual services. The next victim was another prostitute. She'd been soliciting at the curbside on Sunset Boulevard, rode off in a car with a punter, and some hours later, her naked, strangled body was found dumped in a flowerbed in La Crescenta. Again, the fact that she was a hooker seemingly outweighed the fact that she was a 15-year-old homeless runaway with no other means of support. Then things started to get serious. Two women were killed who were not known to have any connection with the commercial sex industry. Elissa Kastin, a young Hollywood waitress, had been abducted and tortured before she was strangled and her naked body thrown down a ravine in Glendale. Jane King was one of many in the neighbourhood of the Dream City who hoped to become an actress or model. She had been suffocated and strangled when her body was found dumped off a motorway ramp. And then things got really serious, the sort of thing every serious citizen does want stopped immediately. Two schoolgirls, aged 12 and 14, were abducted from a bus stop, raped and murdered. Their bodies were found near Elysian Park. A 20-year-old design student was found murdered in Highland Park. A beautiful red-haired business student, just 18 years old, was kidnapped from in front of her parents' house in San Fernando Valley by two men who led her into their car. When her body was found, she'd been raped and then electrically tortured by live wires taped to the palms of her hands before she was strangled. When 18-year-old Kimberly Martin's naked body was found on an Echo Park hillside, nobody fussed any more that she was a modelling agency call girl who had last been seen going to keep a private appointment with an unknown punter in Glendale. Nobody hinted that she took her own risks and received the wages of sin. They just wanted this man caught. In fact, there was to be only one more victim. A young, church-going bank clerk from Glendale was found in her wrecked car, which had plunged over a cliff in the Angeles National Forest. Only she wasn't in the driving seat. She was in the boot, naked and strangled. And the California hillside murders stopped. Suddenly and inexplicably. This is not uncommon in sexual serial murders. A famous parallel case, also in California, would be the still unsolved Zodiac killings. The most famous of all is Jack the Ripper. These cases don't come to an end because the murderers repent or have done all they want at last. They stop as a rule because the murderer is arrested and incarcerated for some other reason without anybody suspecting that he is the murderer, or because he dies, again, unrecognized. Then, early in 1979, a whole state away near Seattle, Washington, police in the small town of Bellingham acted very promptly on a missing person call. 22-year-old Karen Mandy asked for 2 hours off from a job in a department store which was paying her way through college. She explained that he and her roommate, Diane Wilson, had been offered an excellent additional job, house-sitting an expensive property, while its burglar alarm was repaired, and this was the only time they could go and look over the house. She was a responsible young woman, and when 2 hours had run to four and there was still no sign of her, the store manager got a friend to check her out. The friend could not find either Karen or Diana and notified the police. They found both of them unhappily soon. They were in Karen's abandoned car. They had been tied up and raped before they were killed. Theirs was not, however, an impenetrably difficult mystery to solve. Karen had told friends about the house-sitting job. It had been offered her by a good-looking young man who worked for Coastal Security Agency and had previously worked for the store where Karen was employed. He had told her that the house needed sitters temporarily and they would be paid $200. Coastal Security knew nothing about any such house or any broken alarm. The young man, Kenneth Bianchi, made contradictory statements, though he was quite consistent in denying all knowledge of the rape and murder of Karen and Diane. But evidence inside their apartment where the crime had taken place steadily tied him to it. Hairs in the apartment matched his. The underwear he had on at the time of the murders carried blood and semen stains, matching blood and semen in the girl's apartment. Bianchi had been remanded in custody on theft charges when valuable equipment found missing from places he had worked as a security guard turned up in his basement. But it was clear that the more serious murder charge was going to be preferred against him. But something else proved interesting about Kenneth Bianchi. He and his common-law wife had only recently come to Washington State. Previously, they'd been living in Glendale, California, right at the centre of the Los Angeles Hillside murders, which stopped when he left. Now, nobody had ever suspected Bianchi of involvement with those crimes. He was young, healthy, good-looking, personable. If he wanted women, he could have them easily. It is a common but erroneous expectation that the sexual murderer will be an obviously repulsive horror film figure, a sleazy middle-aged creep like Christie, or a savage wild man of the woods. Surprisingly many of these criminals, however, are not only young and attractive, they actually exploit their attractiveness to lead quite active and pretty normal sex lives in parallel with their murderous activities. This does, of course, diminish the likelihood of their acquaintances suspecting them. Los Angeles police struck lucky. After he'd been charged with the murders of Diane Wilder and Karen Mandy, Bianchi pleaded not guilty by reason of insanity, and his insanity proved of great interest to psychiatrists. In the course of interviews, they noticed that his voice, intonation, posture, and outlook would suddenly change. They might be talking to a different person, or persons, several of them. These interviews were videotaped. And it began to seem as though Kenneth Bianchi really was a multiple personality, like the famous woman, not a criminal, usually described as Eve White, or like the infamous rapist Billy Milligan. It seemed that one of Bianchi's personalities, a morose character called Steve, was a violent woman-hater, capable of perpetrating the killings in Washington and the series in California. Only he had an accomplice in California. A real one, not just another aspect of Bianchi's multiple imaginary personalities. The police were disbelieving. Cops hear all manner of excuses and are used to people lying out of self-interest. Psychiatrists, on the other hand, would be encountering a form of insanity if people who paid their massive fees then proceeded to lie to them so that they couldn't get any therapeutic advantage from their treatment. Many shrinks believed in Bianchi's illness. One changed his mind very sharply, however, when he moved from private practice to a court-order practice and started to discover just how many perfectly sane criminals put on very effective fake insane acts to reduce their sentences. He decided Bianchi was faking. Now, if Bianchi went on with the insanity plea and lost, he ran the risk of being executed. Washington State retained the death penalty. If, on the other hand, he could get himself out of Washington and back into the California jurisdiction, he could plea bargain for life all the way. It was obvious that no sensible law enforcement system was ever going to let a man as dangerous as Bianchi walk the streets again. Was it worth risking death just to try and secure incarceration in a mental hospital rather than a prison? Bianchi evidently decided not. He put out feelers and went in for some very elaborate plea bargaining. He would plead guilty to the Bellingham murders in return for assurance that he would be given life sentences. The prosecution insisted that the two should run consecutively and not concurrently, so that he should not be let out on the streets of Seattle. Then he would be transferred to the California jurisdiction, where he would plead guilty to 5 of the Hillside Strangler slayings also. This would do more for the Los Angeles Police Department than clear the case off the books, for he would also name and incriminate his accomplice, his older cousin, Angelo Buono. In return for this assistance, provided his testimony was truthful and led to Buono's conviction, California, having given him another 5 life sentences, would keep him in their prison system. All experienced cons believed California prisons were more comfortable than Washington's. Bianchi went through the agreed routine in Washington. Then he was transferred to Los Angeles, where he revealed that his cousin, who ran a successful home furnishing business, kept a slew of teenage girls on the side and prostituted some of them. Bianchi had killed Yolanda Washington, the black girl who was their first victim. Thereafter, they had usually hunted in couples, often passing themselves off as policemen and telling women to get in their car to come to the station for an interview after flashing false badges. The prosecution foresaw a long trial. There were 10 victims to discuss. Buono was ultimately convicted of killing 9. There were fringe charges of rape and pimping. They tried to cut things short and save the taxpayer money by letting Buono plea bargain for his life. He refused. He stolidly denied everything and declined to testify. The case dragged on into the longest criminal trial ever held in America. While it rambled on, Bianchi involved himself in a totally screwball plot to try and secure his own release, even after he'd pleaded guilty. Mrs. Veronica Lynn Compton was a prison groupie, one of the strange women who become infatuated with the image of notorious criminals and imagine themselves in love with them. Mrs. Compton was 23 years old, dark and beautiful. If such women write to long service prisoners and get photographs through to them, they may well be rewarded with visiting orders. Mrs. Compton, a would-be poet, actress and playwright, visited Bianchi and cooked up a plan to free him. If an identical murder happened while Bianchi and Buono were under lock and key, it would become apparent that they could not have been the Hillside Stranglers. Mrs. Compton agreed to carry one out. But what about the scientific evidence? That was the really cunning part of the scheme. On a visit to Bianchi, Veronica Compton managed to smuggle some of his semen out of the prison. She proposed to daub this around a female victim and, hey presto, it would seem the unfortunate Bianchi had a double who emitted identical semen and killed the women of whose deaths he stood self-accused. The plot went wrong as soon as Mrs. Compton tried to kill a Bellingham cocktail waitress she'd somehow lured into a motel room. As she threw a cord around her intended victim's neck, the waitress carried out a perfect judo move, apparently spontaneously. She reached back, dug her fingers into Mrs. Compton's arms, bent sharply forward and pitched the would-be murderess straight over her head to crash into the furniture and lie stunned on the floor. Mrs. Compton was given a life sentence for attempted premeditated murder. She tried to marry Bianchi from prison, but he'd lost interest in her now the pardon plot had failed. Not that Mrs. Compton lost all interest in his case. She turned up again as a witness on Buono's behalf, claiming that Bianchi had confessed his sole responsibility for the Hillside stranglings, but she had agreed to go along with him in trying to frame Buono. Goodness knows why she told this story. It might have been another misguided attempt to help the rapists. It might have been in return for some offer of favours from somewhere. It might be that hell hath no fury like a really loony imprisoned woman scorned. It might even just have been true. It made no difference. After 200 witnesses, concluding with Bianchi, who held the stand for 4 months, telling a tortuous sequence of confused and self-contradictory stories, the jury convicted Buono of complicity in all the murders with which he'd been charged, except that of the black woman, Yolanda Washington. They recommended life imprisonment without the possibility of parole for each count. The judge would have loved to add the death penalty, and said so. Still one last piece of retribution could be meted out. Bianchi's unhelpful performance in the witness box did not live up to his promised truthful and convincing testimony. The state of California decided it owed him nothing. He was returned to the less comfortable prisons of Washington to complete his sentence. Well, not just his sentences, his life. The man who once looked as though he would make the psychology textbooks and possibly emerge like Billy Milligan, so fascinating and apparently sympathetic in his own right that his vicious crimes might be rather too easily overlooked, has ended up instead a prisoner where he never wanted to be. His notoriety is so unwelcome that he's changed his name twice and is now calling himself Nicholas Fontana.